Our picture of the Viking world would be irrevocably altered by an archaeological find that took place in 1957 close to Roskilde, which was the capital of the Viking civilization in Denmark. The lengthy fjord that stretches from the suburbs of Copenhagen to the Kattegat Strait was the location where a party of sports divers discovered five Viking ships that were substantially undamaged. These ships were found north of the city. Prior to the completion of the comprehensive investigation of the discovery, it would need a considerable amount of time, 5 years, to finish the necessary administration and organization. The damming and draining of a portion of the channel, which took place in 1962, finally brought to light the early medieval history of Denmark in all its splendor. These vessels, which were intentionally sunk by kings in the 11th century as a makeshift stronghold against sea adversaries, provided a perspective that was one of a kind on the daily lives of Vikings. They provided a practical perspective on Viking navigation and fighting, in contrast to the ceremonial ship burials that were common at the time. A period of time that is commonly referred to as the Dark Ages, and during which there was a dearth of literature, was illuminated by this discovery. It was not until at least a century later that chroniclers such as Saxo Grammaticus and Snorri Sturluson started writing down the oral tales that their predecessors had passed down the generations before them. These epic tales, which are replete with heroes, villains, and travels of epic proportions, frequently make reference to enormous dragon ships that were suitable for kings and were manned by hundreds of warriors. Researchers were given their first actual glimpse of these dragon boats that were spoken about in saga tradition. Previously, these dragon boats were regarded to be nothing more than embellishments by medieval writers. One of the ships that was discovered at Skoldalev was a massive war vessel. When everything is said and done, the discovery of the Skoldalev ships was a watershed moment in the field of Viking studies. It provided a one-of-a-kind look into a historical epoch that could have otherwise been lost to the mists of time. The legacy of the saga, which describes heroic deeds, epic journeys, and perilous dragon ships, was commonly received with distrust and rejected as a collection of exaggerated medieval fantasies. This was due to the fact that the saga was a compilation of tall tales. Saga narratives, on the other hand, gained more credibility after the discovery of a massive war vessel in Roskilde in 1997. This vessel was referred to as the Roskilde 6, and it was found there. In comparison to its predecessors, which can be traced back to approximately the year 1025, this monster, which was constructed from two enormous trees and measured 37 meters in length, was noticeably more impressive. There was a set of pieces known as the Roskilde 6 that were intended to demonstrate the majesty and power of Viking monarchs. It is thought that either King Canute or Olaf Haraldsson of Norway was the owner of these items from the beginning. Saga narratives were verified as a result of their discovery, and it was argued that the dragon ships were not only figments of medieval imagination, but actually formidable vessels that were designed for rulers. This interpretation was based on the fact that the dragon ships were discovered. Beginning with smaller crewed ships in the 9th century and progressing to more powerful warships in the 11th century, the history of Viking warfare paralleled the changes that occurred in society, as well as the dynamics of power. This progression began in the 9th century and continued until the 11th century. These ships, each of which was a floating castle with its own story, were a display of royal might and dominance during the time of the Viking Age, when kingdoms were at war with one another. Each of these ships had its own story. A more in-depth understanding of Viking society and the militaristic style of thinking that it held can be gained through the study of this time period, which was distinguished by better literacy and historical documentation. The saga's traditions, which are related with genuine events such as the admission of a pretender to Harald Bluetooth's court, provide light on the political intrigue and militarism that happened in Danish society during the later part of the 10th century. Thingvita. These events include the entrance of a pretender to Harald Bluetooth's court, a remarkable level of unity, the greatest population, and the most fertile farmland were all characteristics that contributed to Denmark's rise to prominence as the most powerful of the Scandinavian kingdoms during the Viking Age. Both Sweden and Norway, on the other hand, were struggling with huge wilderness areas and rival centers of power, while also attempting to assert their independence. A figure who came from poor origins and went on to leave an everlasting imprint on history was Sven Forkbeard. This figure emerged against the backdrop of the geopolitical situation in Scandinavia. As a result of the fact that Sven was reputedly born to a servant girl, he was at a significant disadvantage in Viking Age Denmark because he did not have the backing of a second family. He would soon establish himself to be a capable and valued asset, eventually rising to fame, despite the fact that he had initially experienced a setback. Sven was a member of the Jelling dynasty, which was a family that had achieved dominance over Denmark and the regions that were next to it, earning themselves a large number of enemies along the way. It is primarily via the writings of contemporary German chroniclers like Adam of Bremen, Wittekind of Corvey, and Tietmar of Merseburg that we have gained an insight of Sven, his family, and the legacy that they have left behind. They offer significant insights into the political scene of the time, despite the fact that their ideas are unquestionably impacted by the Christian perspective that they hold with an outsider's perspective. The Icelandic saga traditions, later Danish writers, and the study of archaeology are the sources that we look to in order to supplement and make these stories more insightful. All of these sources, when taken together, offer a vivid picture of the Jelling dynasty's climb to power and the difficulties they encountered along the way. Gorm the Old, Sven's father, is the protagonist of this story. He is a sea king of unknown origins who grabbed control of the Jutland Peninsula in the middle of the chaos that was caused by a German invasion. The Gorm family's hold on money and authority was strengthened as a result of Gorm's strategic seizure of important commercial towns such as Hedeby, which possessed the unparalleled ability to make coins. Gorm and his descendants were able to commission fearsome warships and erect towering wooden strongholds as a sign of their expanding authority as a result of their economic domination. The significance of the Jelling dynasty in the history of marine transportation is highlighted by the fact that in 1935, on a Danish island, what is thought to be one of the earliest of these new breed of ships was discovered, albeit in a ghostly shape. As a tribute to the maritime skill of the Viking Age, the Ladby ship, which is characterized by its unusual dragon-headed prow and remarkable dimensions of about 22 meters in length and 2.9 meters in breadth, stands as a testament. Unlike earlier ships that had several purposes, such as the Gokstad ship, the Ladby ship appears to have been designed specifically for military operations. This suggests that the Ladby ship was the beginning of a tradition that would eventually lead to the creation of enormous dragon boats in the following century. The construction of this vessel exemplifies the strategic significance of naval strength in Viking society. It is possible to transport a huge group of warriors to battle and establish its authority over the oceans. The year 958 marked the year that Harald Bluetooth succeeded his father, and he did not spend any time in establishing his authority and expanding his domain. his first action was to extend his authority to the north by grabbing control of the Vikan region of Norway. This was one of his initial initiatives. In addition, Harald endeavoured to form alliances and broaden his sphere of influence beyond the confines of the Scandinavian world. Harald's aspirations for regional hegemony were demonstrated by the fact that he provided assistance to Richard the Fearless, the Count of Normandy, in his fight against the powerful West Frankish magnates. On the other hand, Harald's ambitions were met with a strong obstacle in the form of East Francia, which was another descendant of Charlemagne's Carolingian Empire. During the reign of Otto the First, East Francia became the most powerful monarchy in Europe, which posed a considerable challenge to Harald's ambitions when he was in power. A significant amount of the German monarch's influence was felt in Denmark, which resulted in the refortification of the Danevork and, in the long run, led to the move of the Danish capital from Jelling to Roskilde. In spite of these mammoth efforts, Harald Bluetooth discovered that he was unable to completely oppose German intrusions into his territory. This led to discussion over the reasons for his decision to convert to Christianity. Harald's eventual conversion to Christianity was likely influenced by a combination of factors, including Christian doctrine that emphasizes the divine right of kings and the allure of new trade opportunities with Christian kingdoms. Some people believe that his conversion may have initially been a strategic maneuver to garner support and protection from Christian rulers. However, others believe that this may not have been the case. In order to further solidify his dedication to his newly discovered faith, Harald performed the symbolic act of reinterring his father in a Christian burial for him. Throughout the entirety of his reign, Harald's power continued to grow, as seen by more territorial conquests and strategic alliances. In 970, Håkon, the son of the Jarl of Lade, who had been murdered, went back to Lade to claim his birthright, which was the province of Lade, which is located in the extreme north of Norway. The old ally of Håkon, Harald Greycloak, who was the last surviving son of Erik Blodaxe, the man who had murdered Håkon's father, was overthrown by Harald, who aided Håkon in his efforts to do so. Harald was able to obtain Håkon's allegiance and the cession of southern Norway to Denmark in exchange for his assistance. Furthermore, Harald's reign expanded into countries such as Volin, which is located in what is now Poland, indicating the breadth of his ambitions beyond the realm of Scandinavia. Harald's image as a powerful and important ruler is further enhanced by the possibility that the settlement of Volin is connected to the fabled Jomsvikingsorder. Enundrasidon. When it comes to the chronicles of Viking history, glimpses into their life frequently emerge from sources that are not expected, such as the stories of travelling merchants like Altatushi. A fresh viewpoint on the Viking Age is provided by his uncommon portrayal of Volin on the Baltic as being more remarkable than Hedeby. In the meantime, the political landscape underwent a transformation as a result of the ascension of Otto II to the position of German monarch, which paved the way for future confrontations. During this time period, Harald Bluetooth, a renowned character, encountered difficulties when the Germans, led by Otto II, conducted raids across the Danevirkeep in the year 974. Harald was unable to oppose the strength of the German army, which resulted in the fall of Hedeby in 975, and might have possibly had repercussions for his reign. Despite his efforts to resist alongside his ally Håkon, Harald was unable to do so. Harald began imposing Christianity upon his subjects as a response to the mounting pressure from the Germans. With this approach, Harald alienated influential figures such as Haakon Jarl in Norway. The events that took place on the opposite side of Europe, however, would soon have repercussions throughout the continent. As a result of the defeat that Otto II endured at the hands of the Kalbid Emir Abul Qasim during the Battle of Stilo, which took place in southern Italy in June of 982, Otto II passed away, and the political landscape of Europe underwent a profound transformation. The fall of Otto II had effects that were felt as far north as the Arctic Circle, when a huge Slavic insurrection broke out, which hindered efforts to Christianize the region for decades. Sweyn, Harald's son, emerged as a formidable Viking warlord in the midst of all of this upheaval. He took advantage of the disarray to retake Hedeby and position himself as a key defender against German attack. A turning point in the history of Scandinavia was marked by Sweyn's acts, which set the stage for future confrontations with his father and his eventual elevation to power. During the Viking Age, which was marked by shifting alliances, political instability, and epic conflicts, there was a rise of leaders such as Sweyn, who would go on to define the destiny of his people for decades to come. Kjartan Landsattern. When it comes to reconstructing the life of Sweyn Forkbeard, the saga of Olaf Haraldsson, which was penned by Snorri Sturluson in the 13th century, is the primary source that we have utilized. Although it was composed considerably later, Snorri's saga draws a significant amount of inspiration from skaldic poetry. This is the case despite the fact that it was written. Poems that are credited to Ari Thorgilsson the Wise are included in this collection. These poems offer valuable insights into Sweyn's time period. Regardless of this, Sweyn's childhood remains cloaked in mystery, and there are conflicting accounts regarding the events that occurred during this time period. The archaeological discoveries shed light on a unique narrative, which indicates that Sweyn was raised in a Christian environment and possessed political acumen. Sweyn is portrayed by Adam of Bremen as a pagan leader, who is typically understood to be related with the Ashrakon, with the folk figure Palnatoke. The results of archaeological excavations, on the other hand, suggest that Sweyn was in fact a Christian. In the vicinity of the year 986, Sweyn's ascension to prominence occurred at the same time that his father, Harald Bluetooth, was falling from power. All of these occurrences took place at the same time. Sweyn's uprising against German invaders was sparked by the events surrounding Harald's death, which may have been influenced by factors such as taxes and religious policy. Sweyn's rebellion was a direct result of these circumstances. The uprising led by Sweyn was supported by allies such as Haakon Jarl of Norway and possibly Erik the Victorious of Sweden. He was able to defend his position as a result of Sweyn's military prowess and strategic connections, which led to engagements such as the seaborne raid on Haakon Jarl's citadel and the marital alliance with Gaitha, who was the sister of Duke Boleslav of Poland. Both of these events were successful. Sweyn's acts are beyond a reasonable doubt evidence of his ambition and diplomatic aptitude, which he utilized in order to successfully negotiate the complex geopolitical terrain of medieval Scandinavia. Sweyn's travels included both Viking raids and maritime endeavors, both of which contributed to the spread of his control and the consolidation of his legacy as a formidable ruler. Sweyn's voyages were characterized by both of these aspects. It is because of the mythical stories that surround Sweyn's rule that his historical story is loaded with layers of mystery and intrigue. An illustration of this can be seen in the narrative that takes place on a small island chain located off the southwestern borders of the United Kingdom. As a consequence of this, Sweyn Forkbeard becomes a person of great significance in the overall history of the Vikings. In his legacy, historical tales are intertwined with myth and folklore, which poses a difficulty to historians who are striving to make sense of the complicated historical events that occurred during his era. The Scilly Isles, which are an archipelago that is located off the southwestern shores of Britain, surprised everyone by becoming a shelter for hermits and holy men during the stormy period of the Viking Age. The Scilly Isles are located in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. This occurred in the midst of the upheaval that was brought about by the invasions and enslavement efforts of the Vikings. A figure of tremendous renown arrived among these windswept islands, commanding a vast fleet of ships that were larger than many of the armies that were dispersed across the terrain during that time period when they were present. This figure was able to land on these islands. Before ascending to the position of leader of his own private army, he was shaped in the crucible of slavery and servitude, despite the fact that he was a prince of Norway by blood. Crowbone was the nickname that was commonly used to refer to Olaf Tryggvason, who was also known by this character. In a manner that is reminiscent of the stories that have been told in the past, Olaf's journey to the Scilly Isles was filled with obstacles and hardships. Olaf's early years were defined by a great deal of struggle, despite the fact that he was born into a noble family and was a descendant of Harald Finehair, the famed first king of Norway. Despite these factors, Olaf's early years were marked negatively. His predilection for pagan divination, a skill that he honed during his difficult time spent as a slave in the Baltic Sea, most likely in the vicinity of what is now Estonia, is the source of his moniker, Crowbone, which may be traced back to his proclivity for the practice. When Olaf was finally freed, he found himself working for the Rus to fulfill his duties. Prince Vladimir, whose men had previously served the legendary Håkon Jarl, was in charge of him. He was responsible for his leadership. When it came down to it, Olaf made the decision to go his own way and eventually tied the knot in the Baltic region and subsequently in Ireland. His dynastic connections were strengthened as a result, and his area of power was expanded as a result of this. His attention was pulled to the Scilly Isles, an area that was steeped in mystery and intrigue, while Olaf was occupied in his travels and forging alliances. The Scilly Isles were filled with mystery and intrigue. A key turning point happened when Olaf came face to face with a Christian hermit on these desolate shores, despite the fact that he adhered to pagan beliefs and customs. This encounter was a significant turning moment. As the story goes, the hermit is claimed to have presented Olaf with an offer of a kingdom in exchange for Olaf's decision to become a Christian. In spite of the fact that the particulars of this encounter are still shrouded in mystery, it serves to bring to light the shifting power dynamics and religious dynamics that existed in the world during the medieval period. During this time period, the Viking Age had left an indelible mark on the landscape of Britain, which was situated on the same body of water as the rest of the world. Anglo-Saxon England, which had been a realm of relative peace under rulers such as Edgar the Pacifier, found itself beset by disputes within its own ranks, as well as challenges from the outside world. However, both of these factors contributed to the country's predicament. A collapse in central authority occurred, which, when combined with factionalism within the court and the dispersion of society, created a climate that was suitable to Viking assaults. This environment was established as a result of the combination of these three factors. In addition to having control across the western coastlines, the descendants of Eivar the Boneless most notably the Uyemer, were responsible for turning the ocean into a safe haven for piracy and looting. The richness of England was ultimately a contributing factor in the country's downfall at the time that Viking longships were looting coastal villages and commercial hubs while they were sailing across the waters of England. These assaults were particularly devastating to cities like Southampton, Thanet, and London, which led to the annihilation of their populations and the collapse of their economies. These cities were particularly badly struck by these assaults. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, which decried the constant assault of Viking invasions year after year, recalled these dreary days. The Chronicle was written in the Middle English language. After Olaf Tryggvason landed with his powerful fleet in the year 991, a significant turning point happened in the history of the world. As a symbol of the recovery of strength among the Vikings, his raids on Folkestone, Sandwich, Ipswich, and Maldon heralded the beginning of a new chapter in the stormy history of England. His exploits also marked the beginning of a new chapter in British history. In the midst of the turmoil that was brought on by Viking attacks and the resistance of the English, Olaf's ambitions were a significant factor. Not only would the actions he carried out in Britain leave an indelible stamp on his legacy, but they would also have an effect on the way history occurred. However, the precise extent of his influence is still a question of debate and interpretation. This is the case even now. A total of 93 ships were brought to Folkestone by Olaf, who then proceeded to undertake raids all around the town. He then proceeded on to Sandwich, and from Sandwich to Ipswich, where he eventually controlled the entire landmass. From there, he headed to Sandwich. Eventually, he arrived at Maldon and settled in. Within the realm of Old English literature, the Battle of Maldon is seen as a significant event that has been commemorated through epic poetry. During the time period known as the Viking Age, this fight was a calamitous occurrence for King Ethelred and his country. On that fatal day, the Viking invaders, who were estimated to number between 2,000 and 5,000 men, came face to face with Earl Brithnoth. Earl Brithnoth cemented his position in legend by killing himself in battle, alongside the Essex Fjord. When we move forward in time to the year 994, the saga tradition weaves the story together with the arrival of an unexpected ally named Sven Forkbeard. He sails from Denmark to join the upheaval that is occurring in England. Sven and Crowbone, as Olaf Tryggvason is known, are the leaders of a combined force of 94 ships that operate throughout Essex, Kent, Sussex, and Hampshire. They are responsible for conducting raids across these regions. The culmination of their campaign, which was marked by an unsuccessful attempt to take control of London, is a merciless rampage over the countryside of England, leaving destruction in their wake. On the other hand, by the year 995, Olaf Tryggvason goes through a tremendous shift, which causes the tide to begin to turn. His baptism, which was performed by the Bishop of Winchester and took place with King Ethelred serving as his godfather, is a momentous occasion. It is hypothesized that Olaf gives up his territorial ambitions in England as a result of Ethelred's sponsorship, which may or may not be accompanied by a hefty bribe. Despite this, Olaf's ambitions to become powerful are not even close to being fulfilled. Olaf, upon his return to Norway, seizes the opportunity afforded by the power vacuum that has been left behind as a result of the death of Hakon Jarl, a veteran warlord and priest king, respectively. Olaf succeeds to the throne, albeit through the use of force and brutality, with the assistance of Håkon's sons. His reign of terror stretches beyond the limits of Norway, engulfing Iceland and the Orkney Islands as one of its territories. Notoriety is earned by Olaf as a result of his autocratic reign, which solidifies his position as one of the most notorious people in the history of the Vikings. During Olaf's ascent to power, he was responsible for the commissioning of a magnificent ship that was given the name the Long Serpent. Olaf's maritime prowess and his goals for control are represented by this magnificent warship, which was painstakingly made and richly decorated. The descriptions of the ship's size, design, and luxurious features highlight the significance of the ship in Viking culture and combat. These descriptions also serve as a testament to Olaf's ambition and authority. As the level of tension between Olaf Tryggvason and Sven Forkbeard continues to rise, the stage is being prepared for a confrontation that will be decisive. This crucial combat takes place in the year 1000, with Olaf's flagship, the Long Serpent, going up against Sven's vessel. The outcome of this battle is determined by the outcome of the conflict. Sven is able to unify Denmark and Norway under his authority as a result of the conclusion of this confrontation, which confirms Olaf's demise and makes it possible for him to bring about his own unification. There is a striking contrast between Olaf's reign of terror and the manner that Sven Forkbeard takes to governing. Sven strengthens his power over Denmark and Norway by using English priests and engaging in individual raids. This marks the beginning of a new era that is marked by diplomatic intrigues and strategic alliances. In the meantime, the legacy of Viking raids and conquests has left the Anglo-Danish population of England in a condition of vulnerability and division, highlighting the lasting impact that this turbulent moment in history has had. During the turbulent time that took place in England, at the beginning of the 11th century, Sven Forkbeard emerged as a pivotal character. This is considered to be one of the most significant moments in the history of the region. From the time when Sven returned to England in the year 1002, there was a great deal of conflict and tension in the country. Incidents such as the massacre that took place on St. Brice's Day, which provided as a pretext for his invasion, were the driving force for this. Sven was finally successful in achieving his goal, which was to be accepted as ruler by the Danelaw and to force King Æthelred to leave to Normandy. This was accomplished in the year 1013. After many years of turmoil and invasions by Vikings, this ambition was finally achieved for the first time. An enormous achievement in the annals of history, Sven's construction of a new capital at Gainsborough marked the beginning of his dominion over Denmark, England, and Norway. Gainsborough was the location of the new capital. On the other hand, Sven's reign in England did not last for even a short period of time. The power vacuum that he left behind and the period of violent turbulence that followed were both caused by his departure at the beginning of February 1014, which was only 5 weeks after he had left. Due to the fact that Danish mercenary commanders, Anglo-Saxon lords, and Viking marauders were all competing for control of the land, war broke out over the remnants of Sven's empire. In spite of the fact that Sven had selected his son Canute as his heir, the Witan, who were the ruling council of elders in England, sent an invitation to King Æthelred to return from his exile in Normandy. King Æthelred accepted the call. The efforts that Æthelred made to regain control of his realm were met with a series of challenges of varying degrees of difficulty. Æthelred had a difficult time reclaiming control of the capital because the Danish loyalists were able to conceal it behind superb river defences at London Bridge. This made it easier for them to maintain their position. During the course of Ethelred's efforts to reclaim the throne, he made a request for the help of mercenaries from Scandinavia. Among these individuals was a young Norwegian by the name of Olaf Haraldsson. There were a number of incidents that took place, one of which was a significant fight that took place at London Bridge. A confrontation between Sweyn's allies and Olaf's soldiers took place during this battle. The goal of the conflict was to reinstate Ethelred to his position as ruler. During this time period, Olaf Haraldsson, who was also referred to as the Stout, distinguished himself as a formidable fighter. One could trace his royal ancestry all the way back to Harald Finehair, the first king of Norway. He was a member of the royal family. In spite of the fact that he had been kicked out of his nation as a consequence of Danish supremacy and political manipulation, Olaf rose to notoriety by participating in raiding activities in the Baltic region and battling against opposing soldiers in Finnmark. Around the year 1010, Olaf and his warriors most likely arrived in England during the stormy age of fighting and power struggles that marked the beginning of the Middle Ages. It was with the expectation of becoming wealthy and securing employment as mercenaries that they travelled to that location. A vacancy was created as a result of Sweyn Forkbeard's passing, which resulted in greater instability during the ongoing struggle for authority. Because of this, the situation became much more dire. Sweyn's designated heir, Cnut, was greeted with opposition from Ethelred's adherents, which led to a complex web of alliances and betrayals. Cnut faced opposition from Ethelred's followers. As soon as everything was said and done, Ethelred was able to regain the crown, and he did it by carrying out a series of harsh retributions against Danish loyalists. Olaf Haraldsson, in the meantime, continued to rise to prominence, earning a place in history as one of the most fearsome persons of his era as a result of his adventures and military prowess. He was able to achieve this by gaining a position in history. The story of Olaf Haraldsson, also known as Olaf the Stout, takes place against the backdrop of shifting alliances, territorial ambitions, and the clash of cultures in the turbulent environment of medieval Europe. Olaf Haraldsson was also known as Olaf the Stout. Despite the fact that Olaf's life and actions are sometimes veiled in myth and folklore, a significant portion of what we know about him comes from historical reports and sagas that provide insights into his life experience. The trip that Olaf takes into the annals of history is linked with the larger Scandinavian tradition of exiled sea kings who are attempting to regain their kingdoms or carve out new regions before returning to their homelands. According to the Chronicles of the 900s, this tradition, which is deeply ingrained in the history of the region, gained dependability, indicating a pattern of royal and aristocratic dynasties pursuing power through conquest and strategic alliances. The fact that Olaf is said to have taken part in the Siege of Canterbury in the year 1011 is a significant and noteworthy incident in his story. In addition to Thorkel the Tall, the commander of the Jomsvikings, Olaf most certainly participated in this campaign, which demonstrated his readiness to get involved in the power conflicts that were taking place during that time period. Olaf's choice to join the siege may have been inspired by Thorkel's alliance with King Ethelred of England, rather than the Danish crown. This decision may have set the stage for Olaf's future undertakings. In the year 1013, Sweyn Forkbeard launched an enormous invasion of England, which marked a turning point in the power dynamics related to the North Sea. Sweyn's ambitious effort sought to achieve domination, not only in a particular region, but also throughout the all of the Kingdom of England. As a result of his success in persuading Anglo-Danes and English nobility to support his cause, King Ethelred was banished, which marked the beginning of Sweyn's rise to power and the dissolution of the political order that had previously existed. On the other hand, Sweyn's unexpected death after his conquest ushered in a new era that was marked by both uncertainty and potential. As a result of Sweyn's passing, Olaf was given the opportunity to go back to his country and press his own claim to authority. After leaving England, Olaf, who had most likely received a sizable payment from King Ethelred for his services, may have embarked on attacks in Iberia before being baptized in Normandy, according to the sagas. Not only do Olaf's acts illustrate the intricate relationship between personal ambitions and political alliances, but they also bring to light the ephemeral nature of power in medieval Europe. His participation in significant events, including the Siege of Canterbury and Sweyn Forkbeard's invasion, had a significant impact on the development of history in the region and exerted an influence on the distribution of power among Scandinavian kingdoms and their geographical neighbours. At the time that Olaf set out on his voyage, he was carrying with him the heritage of his ancestors, as well as the weight of his own dreams. He was navigating the perilous waters of medieval politics and warfare. In spite of the fact that it was unknown whether he would become a conqueror, a king, or a footnote in history, his biography reflected the turbulent yet vivid fabric that was the medieval world. On the unstable terrain of medieval Scandinavia and England, the ascent of notable personalities like Olaf Haraldsson and Canute heralded enormous transformations in power relations and the direction of history. These shifts came about as a result of the turbulent terrain. Canute and Olaf Haraldsson are two examples of figures that fall within this category. Olaf, who was sometimes referred to as Olaf the Stout, was the first person to emerge as a formidable commander. By achieving strategic victories and demonstrating his expertise in the sea, he was able to reclaim the throne of Norway and establish his authority. Canute, the son of Sweyn Forkbeard, was able to skillfully manage the complex political landscape of England during this time period. In the end, he was able to come to the throne of England, and he left behind a legacy that was characterized by cooperation and government. It was at the time that Olaf Haraldsson returned to Norway that a fundamental shift occurred in the history of the country. After the small lords were subjugated in the year 1015, Olaf was able to consolidate his power through a series of military triumphs, the most significant of which was the decisive Battle of Nesjard, which took place in the year 1016. Olaf was able to strengthen his control and put Norway together under his leadership as a result of this victory. Through the commissioning of the construction of massive Viking longships like the Bison and the Karl's Head, Olaf was able to demonstrate his commitment to naval dominance and the projection of power on both the domestic and international levels. His authority and his aspirations to become a marine explorer were represented by these longships. After Sweyn Forkbeard, Sinut's father, passed away, Canute began his journey to become the King of England. He was determined to succeed his father. In the same time period as Olaf was working to strengthen his position of control in Norway, this endeavor was also taking place. Canute, who was promised England but did not have a country to support him, formed a broad coalition of forces in order to recapture the kingdom. These armies included Danes, Norwegians, Swedes, Poles, and troops from other countries. Senuta's powerful navy launched an invasion of England, which resulted in the country's easy conquest and subsequent division among his allies. Alongside him were seasoned leaders such as Thorkel the Tall and Jarl Erik Harkonsen, who were also on his side. He was accompanied by these individuals. In the beginning, Edmund Ironside, who was Ethelred's son, put up some fight. Nevertheless, in the end, Sinuti's forces were victorious and were able to secure territories all throughout England's domain. In contrast to merely subjugating the English, Canute made it quite obvious that he was willing to collaborate with them, which is a significant advancement. Sinuti's diplomatic skills and strategic acumen were on full show in this approach, which established the foundation for effective governance and stability in the kingdoms that he had lately acquired. Sinuti's strategy laid the foundations for these improvements. As a result of his reign, Canute was able to manage the complexities of medieval politics with knowledge and determination. And as a result, he left behind a legacy of successful government and partnership. The reign of Canute, which was defined by his consolidation of power, expansion of lands, maritime dominance, economic superiority, military campaigns, cultural ambitions, and enduring legacy, was a significant chapter in the history of Scandinavia. It was a chapter that emphasized an important chapter in the history of Scandinavia. Sinuti's marriage to Emma of Normandy, who was Ethelred's widow, was one of the most significant reasons that led to his success in solidifying his position. This was one of the most crucial variables at the time. Not only did this alliance strengthen his hold on power in England, but it also helped him establish relationships with influential Norman dynasties, such as Godwin of Wessex and Leofwine of Mercia. Every single one of these coalitions was a direct consequence of this marriage. By forming these agreements, Canute was able to extend his sphere of influence beyond the English Channel, so establishing himself as a powerful ruler in the region. This allowed him to establish himself throughout the region. More than just the borders of England and Denmark, the dominion of Canute encompassed places such as the Irish Sea and the Scottish Islands, both of which had been influenced by Norse culture for a substantial amount of time. Sinuta's dominion went beyond the borders of England and Denmark. Ireland, the Isle of Man, and even Strathclyde were some instances of regions that displayed distinctive Norse identities. Other examples include Strathclyde. As an illustration, royal burials sometimes took place in boats, which is indicative of the deeply ingrained pagan practices that were prevalent at the time. The fact that even countries such as Galloway exhibited hints of adopting Norse customs is evidence of the broad influence that Sinuti's reign had. This is evidence that can be observed around the world. The foundation of Sinuti's authority was his dominance in the maritime sphere, which was illustrated by the construction of magnificent dragon-headed ships such as the Roskilde 6. Sinuti's dominance lay at the heart of his authority. Not only did these sturdy vessels serve as a representation of Sinuti's dominance, but they also made it simpler for him to exert his dominion over the oceans. The consequence of this was that he was able to establish his dominance over a number of kingdoms and trade routes that were located throughout the North Sea region. It was under the reign of Canute that cities such as York, Dublin, and Hedeby became important trading hubs. As a consequence of this, the Carolingian North Sea trade system was supplanted by a new economic network. This network, which made it feasible for specialized vessels known as canars to perform deep sea trips into the Atlantic Ocean, ushered in an era of economic prosperity and cultural exchange. It also made it possible for people to make connections with one another. Additionally, the existence of this network made it feasible to carry out trade missions that were more widespread. Cianuta's military successes assisted him in further consolidating his rule by leveraging the resources of England and Denmark to expand his frontiers. This allowed him to further expand his territory. Because of this, he was able to stretch out his area. The conflicts that Canute had with the monarchs of the region, such as Olaf of Norway, brought to light his ambitions to establish himself as the dominant figure in the area. It was during these battles that significant moments occurred in the history of Scandinavia. Canute had ambitions in the fields of arts and politics, in addition to the accomplishments he had achieved in the military. He hoped to be as influential in history as individuals such as Athelstan and Charlemagne, and he wanted to follow in their footsteps. His journey to Rome, which he took in the company of Conrad, the Holy Roman Emperor and King of Germany, was proof of his aim to establish a connection with European powers and to position himself as a European king who possessed modern sensibilities. In spite of the fact that Cianuta's North Sea dominion was destroyed during his reign, his authority had a lasting impact on European history, shaping the way events would unfold for decades to come. His rule had an influence on the way events would eventually develop. Nevertheless, the Viking Age had not yet reached its conclusion.